Do you want to catch bugs before they get into production? Join us on the DevOps Lab, where we'll look at integrating ReGrade into our pipelines. Welcome to the DevOps Lab. I'm Steve Morawski, and today I'm joined by Robert Ross, and we're going to be talking about how to preview your software behavior and avoid zero-day bugs in production. Welcome, Robert.
Hello.
So why don't you tell me a little bit about what we're going to see here today and how that can help me avoid some zero-day bugs, because you know what? I'm really good at writing those.
So We've got software that can help check what you think the changes are in your new network service release and verify that the changes actually line up with what you expect the changes to be. And so, you know, as we know, that the bugs in our software that we introduce are some kind of behavior that we didn't intend to introduce that's changed from the previous version. And so this allows us to identify those changes and verify that we've got them right.
All right. And what's doing this, right? Who are you?
So we are Curtail. We've got a software product that can look at the network traffic to do this. And our software product basically can look at the requests and responses going to some existing network service and its environment. And then it can translate those requests into a secondary environment running against another instance of the software, and can then compare those responses with the original responses and identify cases where that has changed in performance or in the behavior of the actual response content.
So I don't have to like grab a web proxy and track all this stuff and then replay things myself in my own production environment against my own test environments, because I used to have to do that back in the day. Sounds like this is going to help me do that, but as part of my CI/CD pipeline, or how are we going to integrate this?
Yeah, so actually the demo that we've got today is integrated into the CI/CD pipeline. So what we've got to show today is basically a sample product. It's actually an open source application that you can find out there in the world called Ghost, which is a content management system. And they had a regression when they released version 2.2.3. And so we've actually got an environment set up where we're running Ghost in the Azure Kubernetes system on using DevOps, the DevOps lab for the Azure DevOps for the CI/CD pipeline. And we're actually hosting the repository in GitHub here. And basically, in the demo, we'll show that when we check into GitHub, that's going to trigger the normal tests in the CI/CD pipeline. Our typical test cases actually pass, not finding the bug in the new release. But then ReGrade identifies there's a change that wasn't accounted for. And we can use that as a gate in our CI/CD pipeline to prevent the final deployment when there is an unaccounted for change, which in this case shows finding that bug before release.
Well, if you're ready, how about we take a look?
All right, sounds good. So here we can see our Azure DevOps environment, and we've got a pipeline that I've set up to show this. And we can see that on the previous commit with Ghost version 2.2.2, there were no problems. All of the stages passed. We built the image successfully, we tested successfully, and we deployed successfully. We're going to do a couple things here. So I'm going to start off a new build. So I'm going to check in the changes for version 2.2.3 of Ghost. And once I do that, this is going to recognize that I just made the check in to GitHub. And it's going to start building. And it's going to run through all these various steps of building and testing. And when we get to the test stage, we actually have ReGrade here as a gate. So while we're waiting for this to run, we can go ahead and take a look at what the nature of the bug was so that we'll understand what the results are that we get back from ReGrade. So if we take a look here at, this is actually logging into Ghost version 2.2.2. And logging into this version, we will see what the correct behavior looks like. So this is actually going to not show us a bug right here. This is just going to familiarize us with what it's supposed to look like. So you log in, you see basically your old blog posts and who posted them. And to make it easy to identify, we've got all the number, all the names of the posts by numbers here. So you can scroll back and see the older numbered posts, and the numbers count down as you might expect. And ultimately, it gets down to 3, 2, 1, and then you can see that the initial posts that are there from when you first install the system. So that's what it's supposed to look like when everything is behaving correctly. Now, what actually happened in version 2.2.3 is they had a regression. And in the regression in version 2.2.3, you initially log in. And maybe the tests when you log in, this might have been as far as they go. And if you just look at, you know, hey, are the, is blog post 31 there? Did I log in? Looks like everything's fine. But in the interaction with this, if you scroll down and you get down past the 3.2 where there should be 1, instead it repeats. So now you get 31 again and then 30. And if you continue to scroll down looking for where blog post 1 is, you can actually never find it. So clearly it's not showing us the right results here when we look through these pages. And so this is the issue that we're going to actually detect, because we've got an understanding of what was supposed to change in this new release. And we can actually look at the previous release while that test is running. And so here everything's green. These are all the different parts of the responses that we compared for the previous release. So we're looking at the HTML contents. We're looking at individual attributes and elements for the structures of that document. We're looking at the HTTP response and header fields, the actual JSON documents and their structures and values inside of them, streamed data coming back. So we take a look at all of this, and in the run for 2.2.2, we were able to see that there were no unexpected differences. So this is continuing to build and run. So this might take a minute here. But once this is done, this is building the environment. And it's then going to, right now it's deploying a test environment into the Kubernetes into the Kubernetes cluster. So it's going to create a temporary namespace and deploy the product there. And then once it's deployed in that temporary namespace, we're going to run a standard set of Selenium tests against it to validate the functionality. And what's actually going to happen as the final result here is that those Selenium tests are going to succeed. Everything's going to say that it would pass. And then we're going to go to this ReGrade gate step. And the ReGrade gate step is actually making an API call to an Azure function, which is then integrating with our API in our product's user interface. And our API is then giving a response back that indicates that whether or not there is unexpected changes outside of what the developer anticipated and put in the database before the test run. So we'll see that in a minute.
So Robert, where are we getting that known good or that expected good behavior? Is that something you can figure in ReGrade ahead of time?
Yeah,
or
really what we do is we validate that the changes are the expected set of changes. And so what that means is that we're comparing against some previous version of the product. Often this will be the immediate previous version, but depending on the release environment, sometimes this could skip releases as well. But basically the idea is validating that for this set of test traffic, there's a certain things that should change between these releases. And developers can go into our user interface and they can identify which of these things they expect to have changed. And so they can, for example, run their small unit tests or their individual tests and mark the things that they know they actually modified that are part of what they intended to modify for this release. So once that's in there, we can then categorize what all of the changes are that have been made. And then we can compare that to what the developers have effectively signed off on as their intended changes for this release. And so then any changes that a developer didn't say they intended to make then get flagged for review for someone to verify that they're either a legitimate change that was intended for this release or this is something that needs to be fixed.
All right, that makes sense. So we take the previous release or a previous release that gives us our starting place, and then we can flag what's a bug versus what's a feature. And sometimes, you know, hey, sometimes those bugs are features, but just not intended features.
Right. Yeah. I mean, there's some very subtle things that get caught, right? I mean, some existing tools can catch things where you have a bug that, you know, before you would return a valid result, and now you're just returning an error code instead. we can catch much more subtle differences. Like, for example, before, you know, you're returning the number 123, and now you're returning a social security number. Those kinds of things can be very significant changes in the code that you don't want to miss, but are the kind of things that a lot of traditional tools just won't tell you about. So here we can actually see that the regrade gate did fail. And we can see here because it was there was unknown alerts. There was four unknown alerts there. And so it did not deploy. Now, if we go to our graphical user interface, we can actually see this test run that's associated with what just happened. And we can see that there were a number of differences that were marked as intended based on the developers that got automatically filtered out. And there was four unknown alerts. And so we can see that basically the differences were in the JSON bodies that came back from some response. And we can see also that all of those differences that were unknown happened on a single HTTP request. So drilling into that request, things start to look interesting quickly. We can see that it's an API call to get the posts for page 2, which starts to sound very familiar for exactly where that bug was. The unexpected change was incorrect content coming back on page 2. If we look at this, we can now see that on page 2, there was actually four differences that we found. And that one was that there's an array called posts that has a different length. Second was that there's this meta pagination block inside the JSON document, and the page number changed. So when we asked for page 2, we were getting page 2 before, but now with the new 223 software, we asked for page 2, and we're getting back what's called what is saying it's page 1. So there's a lot of interesting information here. We also can look at it in other ways. We have timestamps and IPs and ports and packet capture you can look at. We also have the ability to even replay these things. So you can say, take the entire session and replay it into a developer environment from the beginning and recompare that as well. You can export the report or export the request to curl if that's what you want to do. So we have all those. And then you can also view the JSON in context. So this request that had the difference, the bug that we saw when we were looking at things, you can see side by side what it looks like when we get the responses back. And so recall we asked for page 2 from this data set. The good system here on the left returns page 2, which doesn't have a next, and the previous was 1. And then here, instead on page 2, we asked for page 2, but it gave us page 1 again, which said that the next was 2 and the previous was null. And so this quickly lets us identify where actually something went wrong in our code. And what it is that we need to fix. And so we can see that there was a lot of changes that were introduced, but most of these changes were actually the intended things. There were some, you know, minor HTML attribute differences and those things that we can filter out based on our rule set. We also have the ability with all of this to track performance information. So we can actually see what the response times are from the two services. And we actually have this down to the granularity of knowing matched pairs. So we can actually identify an individual request that was slower on one service versus the other. And we can also do interesting things with the statistics, like finding which API calls are associated with a slowdown, or whether it is a specific subset of the traffic associated with a slowdown, or whether it's maybe something that's changing over time or related to the environment or something along those things. So we have a lot of information about that that we can compare side by side, not just the response content, but the performance as well. And then all of this is stored historically, so you can keep track of these runs over time. Awesome. And then just as one last thing for the sake of completeness, I've now checked in also while I was talking there, I checked in Ghost version 2.2.4, which was the next release of the Ghost software, the open source. And it had a fix for version 2.2.3. And so using the same rule set that we have in there in terms of the intended changes, this is running through these same exact sets of changes and testing with 2.2.4. And this ultimately will actually pass the test because in 2.2.4 they fixed the bug. And so there's no longer that same unintended change showing up.
So Curtail is going to be... ReGrade is going to be taking a look and comparing against the last successful deployment out into production, or to whatever I said was the last successful thing to go compare against, and then let me try version after version until I get something right.
Yes, exactly. Yep. So until you have the changes match what you expect those changes to be.
Perfect. Very cool. And I really like how it breaks it down into like, so I can see kind of even the JSON response difference, right? So even if I like swapped out JSON serialization libraries, I may be able to catch some unexpected behavior there. Not that I've been bit by, you know, changing versions of serialization libraries before.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, this is the kind of thing that, you know, supply chain attacks have been in the news a lot recently, right? Where a lot of us now rely on NPM and Ruby Gems and all these common open source repositories of libraries. And we don't really know who's out there maintaining that software, who's updated it last. And these new versions get pulled all the time in our CI/CD frameworks. And so this gives us a way to check and identify what has actually changed, even when we didn't intend to change anything by updating to that new version.
Yep. Very cool. So Robert, how does one go get started with ReGrade?
You can contact us on our website. We have pages on there that you can contact us to get started with a proof of concept. It's super easy to get this deployed. Basically our deployment, we run as a couple containers. We've got our user interface. We've got our actual network sensor, and then we've got the database that actually stores the configuration and the results. So depending on the cloud environment, like this one here, I mean, we can generally get a proof of concept up and running in under an hour. And then it depends on how complex the integrations are from there for, you know, that particular environment and the software packages.
Very cool. Well, thank you so much for introducing us to ReGrade, and, you know, really looking at how we can take, and compare behavior between versions as part of our CI pipeline, not just as part of, you know, hey, I got to follow through and check and make sure how these things are going or cobble together my own scripts to replay things. I wish I had this. I wish I had this 10 years ago when I was trying to get new versions of software deployed into different environments and things. It seems like it would streamline a lot for me. Thank you so much for taking some time today to join us on DevOps Lab and share a little bit about what you're doing.
Yep, thank you.